Psyche Cattell was born in 1893 in Garrison-on-Hudson, New York. She was the third of seven children, born to James McKean and Josephine Owen Cattell. She received two master's degrees before going on to earn a doctorate in education from Harvard in 1927. Her graduate work, with its focus on child development and education, earned her a research fellowship in the Harvard Growth Study, a large-scale, longitudinal study of the physical and intellectual development of nearly 300 children. During her years at Harvard, Dr. Cattell developed ways to evaluate the abilities of infants and young children. Her tests were direct, often employing standard household items, and were used by psychologists and educators for decades. In 1938, as the growth study was concluding, Dr. Cattell was planning a move to rural Lancaster, Pennsylvania. In 1941, while practicing at a local clinic and continuing to produce kits for her infant intelligence tests, she established a daycare and kindergarten in her home.
Hudson Cattell, her son. She was homeschooled, and she never went to college. So her first degree was a master's, I think, from Cornell, and another one from Harvard, and she was the first woman to get an EDD from Harvard. Her work at Harvard was developing an infant intelligence test. So the test was finished, and we moved to Lancaster, I guess, in 39, and the reason for it was mother's brother, Jacques, was the manager of the printing plant down here. Grandfather and grandmother, they moved here, I think, during the war, I think it was 42, and they built an apartment above the printing plant. Nursery school as a institution was just getting started, and basically it got started for nursery training at Harvard. The book had just come out, and she had been interested in starting the school, and the school opened on September 9, 1941. It started out with four children. The first teacher she hired there was from the nursery training school. Before World War II, Lancaster was really a closed society, and she talked to a lot of the doctors around, and most of the doctors didn't really see any need for a school, didn't appreciate what a school could do. There was no support there. There was one school, it wasn't a school really, it was an elaborate daycare center, and people thought, well, this is going to be the same thing. So there was basically no support whatever in the community for it. There were four children in the first year. Susie Benson was one. She came, and her mother, I think, helped out with the school a bit, and there was no tuition. I mentioned Jack Cattell, and his son was one of them. My sister was another. There was one tuition-paying student. I don't know what would have happened if it hadn't been for World War II. But with the onset of World War II, things changed, and a lot of women went to work or volunteer or whatever. So that was one of the things that really got the school started. The school was simply for young children, nursery school, to begin with. And it was that way for 2 years. Then the name changed to the West End Nursery School and Kindergarten. And so did the age of the children.
I'm Susanna Benson. I attended the Cattell School from 1942 until my graduation in, was it June 1945, at the recommendation of my mother's lifelong friend, Ruth Hemington Kurtz. She was a social worker. My mother did historical research for a professor at the University of Pennsylvania. During the war, my mother was living alone on a little farmette. My father was at sea. I was told by my mother that when she took me there the first day, I never looked back, that I vibrated with delight at seeing all the children. And a teacher remarked to my mother, "She's not a clinger." During sharing time, I never said a word because I couldn't talk, and according to my mother, I'd only been with her and hadn't heard many conversations. So the teachers would say, Someday Susanna will talk to us. The school, which was in a big house where Psyche Cattell lived and surrounded by very tall hemlock bushes, and we had a big yard to play in. I recall raking leaves at the school, and I used to love to do that. And the other thing I loved to do was swing on the swings. I would swing as high as I could, and in one of these photographs, I am almost at the top of the bars, and I don't ever remember being scolded or being told, don't go that high or you'll fall, the way you often hear parents do these days. So we were obviously permitted to swing as high as we cared to. When I walked into the school, the very first thing that happened is that I was checked by the nurse, and she was checking, as far as I knew, for sore throats. I must have had a sore throat once, because I know I always, if I had any kind of scratchy throat, I was always very relieved to know that I could stay at school and wouldn't be sent home.
I'm Janet Myers Struby. I worked at the school from 1966 to 1971. I didn't have a college degree, so I worked under her and checked all my plans with her. She said, you need to go to college. Then eventually I went to Millersville. The background that I gained from Dr. Cattell was just everything I needed to work with children. The program was very formed. We had a set schedule, and we had art, we had music, and she had a system when you went out in the playground. The toys were in a garage, and when you got the bicycles out, they go back in their right place. And the children had a certain pattern as they rode their bicycles. And if things weren't going well, she'd be watching out her window. If things weren't going well, she'd come darting out, coatless, in the winter, and let us know that, that wasn't the way things should be going. She had Mrs. Esther Herr, who taught elocutions. And she had all these wonderful books of cute little poems that we would use in the programs, the Christmas program, the spring program, and the graduation. But I enjoyed her because I enjoyed her philosophy of entwining limits with love. And I strongly believe that we do need limits, but we have to be consistent. And she stressed that.
If the child knows for certain what the consequences of cooperation or non-cooperation will be in a specific situation, he will not feel the need to test the limits. He will know them.
This is Paula Graham, and I taught at the Cattell School in the early 70s. The way I came to know about this school was that a neighbor had mentioned, I was looking for a place for my daughter to go, and they mentioned the Cattell School, so we took her over, interviewed, she got accepted. And I was talking to Dr. Cattell one day, saying I'd be a few minutes late picking Jessica up because I had to be volunteering downtown at a Head Start center. And her eyes lit up and she said, oh, are you interested in early childhood education? And I said, yes, as a matter of fact, I am. She said, I need a teacher. Would you be interested in the job? And I said, well, maybe. So on the spot, we had a job interview. And she handed me a puzzle, a play school puzzle with many, many parts. It was a giraffe. She took it apart and put it in my lap. And she said, here, put this puzzle together. And I managed to do it. And she hired me and said that the only thing was I'd have to wear a longer skirt, that I couldn't wear mini skirts to teach at her school. I had just moved to Lancaster, had spent a year in Cambridge, Massachusetts. I had no idea she had Harvard connections, but I had taken a course at the Radcliffe School on alternative education. So I was fresh from the completely opposite perspective of the Cattell School. I couldn't quite believe my eyes. It was a Victorian home, very fancy. I'm thinking about lace and glass cups the children had their tomato juice in at snack time. Those hemlock hedges around the corner of the property. It was very contained, maybe mahogany, I don't know what the wood was, but wooden lockers and dark linoleum floors. It was a step out of time for me. And yet I took the plunge and took the job. Now, my classroom was right above her office. And like I said, it was a linoleum floor. The kids were building with the building blocks, towers, which they would knock down and then shout in glee. And I remember one day, Psyche stormed up the steps and looked at me and said, "I have never had a teacher who could tolerate so much noise." But I didn't say anything to her until after school was dismissed, and I asked her, please, if she had to correct me, could she do it to me and not in front of the children? I thought that was pretty humiliating. But she didn't care. Her philosophy was, you have to do it on the spot. Whether it's a child, whether it's a teacher, the correction has to go right there at that moment, because they're not going to remember, you know, 20 minutes, half hour afterwards, what they did wrong. Once a week, I think, we would have an assembly, and all the children would gather for singing and for recitation. When I interviewed for the job, I was told that there was a drama teacher. Wow, was I excited. I thought that was so cool. What it turned out was, it was Miss Herr, and I guess you would say it was elocution lessons. So the children would memorize and recite little bits of poetry, and if they behaved, she would reward them with a piece of candy. Anyway, the kids would get up and they would say their little poems, and then we would sing. Mrs. Athey taught the piano, or played the piano, I mean, and I remember after music class, the children would sing, thank you very much, Mrs. Athey, thank you very much.
At my kindergarten graduation, I remember wearing a white pinafore and handing out the programs. We watercolored with bluebirds on them. And as I handed those out, I made the decision that I would be a kindergarten teacher. That was in 1945, and that is what I actually did with my life.
She retired when she was 80. She was perfectly capable of running the school for more years than that, but she felt that she didn't want to be in the position of starting to fail and have people notice it and so forth, so she decided to get out when she was on top.
Dr. Cattell closed the school in 1974, but continued to practice and advise parents through invited talks and a featured newspaper column.
Short of absolute necessity, a child who is afraid of strangers should not be left alone with a person with whom he's not well acquainted. To wake up and find only strangers present must have been a terrifying experience for this 2-year-old, who had never before been left with anyone except one of the 3 members of his family. This frightening experience will make it difficult for the child to learn to accept his mother's temporary absence. I think she should move slowly.
I just believed in Dr. Cattell's philosophy. She loved the children, and she would encourage them. She'd give them a pat. She'd give them a smile. She would give them a hug. But yet, the rules were the rules.
There were rules and regulations on the playground. Certain vehicle tricycles and moving toys had to go in a certain direction. There were places to stop. Everything was very regulated. And I couldn't quite wrap my mind around that. And I thought, when I left there, I have just spent 2 years learning everything in the world not to do. But as it turns out, I carried a lot of her wisdom with me. One of the things I believe all that rigidity and structure was about was providing children a safe environment and good boundaries, so that they knew their limits, just like her book, Raising Children with Love and Limits. As the teachers, we had to step in if they went over the limit, just as she encouraged parents to do, not to punish them, but to know that the adults were in charge. And with the adults in charge, the children could go about the business of being children and learning and playing and doing things that kids do. And it makes a lot of sense to me. So I think safety is sort of an underrated issue. And I really admired her. I wish she had explained it a little better so I could have understood it at the time, but it's been one of those things that I've carried with me. The world's a scary place, but if you know the limits and good boundaries, I think it really helps you flourish within wherever you are.
I went one time, and there was a robin at her window, and it kept banging against the window. And finally she said, I guess he sees his image in the window. So she opened the window, hoping that he would come inside, but he didn't. He just sat, you know, outside, but he kept going up and down. And so she loved nature. She really loved nature. And we would just visit. I'd take her some cookies or something like that. And we just sat and chatted about teaching and what I was doing. So I always had questions for her. And I just enjoyed her just so. And she was really my mentor. She really was. And friend. So I think the world of her.
I remember those kids like it was yesterday. They thrived. They seemed to love it. So I can see the wisdom. I just couldn't understand it then. And probably because I just felt she was challenging me all the time, and I was challenging her too.
The Cattell School operated for 33 years and educated over 1,000 children. She created what is now an historic landmark in Lancaster City, and her influence is still felt by educators and many residents who spent their earliest years at the Cattell School.